Martin Amis was born in 1949 in Oxford, where his father, the Booker Prize-winning author Kingsley Amis, was a doctoral student.
Martin Amis grew up in several university towns where his father taught literature: Swansea, Princeton, and Cambridge.
At 18, a role in the film A High Wind in Jamaica took him to the West Indies. He later returned to England and enrolled in Exeter College, Oxford.
In his early 20s, Martin Amis wrote book reviews for The Observer. And soon after, he started working as an assistant editor at the Times Literary Supplement. Then he began his career as a novelist.
As a novelist, Martin Amis exposes the excesses of late capitalist Western society, the absurdity of which he often satirizes through grotesque caricature.
Martin Amis has first he is known as a novelist, then he has wrote a screenplay also, which is very famous, Saturn Tree. He has another profession as a journalist also.
Novelist, journalist and screenplay writer.
Yes.
His first novel, The Rachel Papers, was published in 1973, and his second novel, Dead Babies, in 1975. In The Rachel Papers, the protagonist is Charles Highway, nearly 20 and struggling to prove his manhood. He learns the lessons of love through some mistakes of the flesh. In Dead Babies, a grotesque collection of young people gathers for a weekend in an English country house to try out sex and drugs in as much variety as they know.
From 1977 to 1980, he wrote two more novels, Success and Other People. In 1984, his best-selling novel, Money, appeared, followed by a collection of journalistic essays and a collection of short stories.
Success is the story of two brothers, Gregory Riding and Terry Service, and their rising and falling fortunes. This was the first example of Amis's fondness for symbolically pairing characters in his novels, which has been a recurrent feature in his fiction. Money, subtitled A Suicide Note, is a first-person narrative by John Self, advertising man and would-be film director, who is addicted to the vices of the 20th century.
Money is a satire on Thatcherite immorality and greed. It is the story of John Self, who is also the narrator of the novel. John Self is a successful director of advertisements who is invited to New York by Fielding Goodney, a film producer, in order to make his first film.
John Self is a hedonist who leads a loose life. He has an insatiable appetite for money, alcohol, fast food, drugs, pornography, prostitutes, and more. And the novel Money is a tale of a life lived without restraint, a tale of money and the disasters it can precipitate.
In London Fields, a global catastrophe, which Amis simply calls the crisis, is approaching. Against this backdrop of environmental, moral, and social degradation, and the looming threat of world instability and nuclear war, a dark murder mystery unfolds. In this novel, there is a murderer, there is a victim. But the victim is searching for her murderer. She knows the time, she knows the place, she knows the motive, she knows the means. She just doesn't know the man.
Samson Young, or Sam, the unreliable narrator of the novel, is an American, a failed non-fiction writer with decades-long writer's block, and is slowly dying of some sort of terminal disease.
He comes to the Black House, an undesirable public house, and finds the main players of his drama assembled there, waiting for the drama to begin. All Samson has to do is to write it down as it happens.
This is the story of a murder. It hasn't happened yet, but it will. It had better. I know the murderer. I know the murderee. I know the time. I know the place. I know the motive, her motive. And I know the means. I know who will be the foil, the fool, the poor fool, also utterly destroyed. I couldn't stop them. I don't think, even if I wanted to. The girl will die. It's what she always wanted. You can't stop people once they start. You can't stop people once they start creating. What a gift. This page is briefly stained by my tears of gratitude. Novelists don't usually have it so good, do they? When something real happens, something unified, dramatic, and pretty saleable, and they just write it down. At the Black Cross, Sam meets Guy Clinch, a rich upper-class banker who is bored with life, with his terrifyingly snobbish American wife, Hope, and his out-of-control toddler, Marmaduke. Sam also meets Nicola Six, whose diaries Sam gets to read when she dramatically dumps them into a waste bin. These diaries tell Sam that Nicola believes she can somehow see her own future.
Bored with life and the aging process, Nicola is plotting her own murder to take place on the midnight of 5th November, her 35th birthday. She manipulates the entire cast of characters to bring about her own murder. Sam, who considers that he lacks the imagination and courage to write fiction, realizes that he can simply document the progress of Nicola's plan towards the murder in order to create a good story.
Nicola has been pretending to Guy Clinch that she is a frigid, sexually timid virgin, and she teases him sexually at every opportunity. Nicola insists that Guy leave his wife and son to consummate their relationship, and Guy does so, destroying his family life. Sam assumes that Guy would drive Keith Talent, a small-time criminal, into murdering Nicola. Sam enters into a strange relationship with Nicola, where he regularly interviews her and is updated on the plot.
But there is an unexpected twist at the finale. In one of Samson's terrifying dreams, the reader is left utterly confused.
The novel is very clearly about the link between reading and information gathering and the reliability and unreliability of narrators and narratives.
And about the title. There is a park in London called London Fields, but it does not feature in the novel. However, the title London Fields may suggest a pastoral rural setting within a modern urban setting.
However, there is an inherent paradox. As Sam himself remarks, in London there are no fields, only fields of attraction and repulsion, fields of force.
Explores how life would appear, how it would feel, and what sense it would make if it were a movie running backwards.
Time's Arrow begins with the end of the life of Dr. Todd T. Friendly. When the story begins, he's extremely old and is in an American hospital just about to die. And then the doctor's consciousness starts to relive the doctor's life backwards.
As a doctor in a world where everything moves backwards, Friendly causes injuries on his patients rather than healing them. In this crazy world, old people grow younger and become more vigorous. Children grow smaller and eventually enter hospitals from which they never return. Eating, drinking, lovemaking, and even an abortion are all described in the reverse.
It turns out that Friendly, before he became Friendly, lived two other lives as Adam Young and Odilo, to escape his guilt as a participant in the Holocaust, specifically at Auschwitz.
With time running backward, we see that negatives become positives. The doctor creates life, heals wounds, and sends the inmates to freedom. Things that are quite opposite to what he had done in the Holocaust.
The story concludes with Odilo first meeting his wife, and then as an innocent young boy at conception.
What is depicted in the novel is a disorienting reverse technology of the doctor's life. This technology accentuates the trauma on which the novel is centered. The narrator is constantly baffled by his environment, yet he knows he is inevitably heading towards its predetermined course.
After Time's Arrow, Martin Amis wrote The Information and Night Train, a best-selling detective thriller set in an unnamed city in the United States.
The Information involves two 40-year-old novelists, the successful Gwen Barry and the not-so-successful Richard Tull. This novel is about literary envy.
The novels Money, London Fields and The Information are called the London Trilogy. They are all set in West London, a nasty and immoral place. All these novels examine the lives of middle-aged men, anti-heroes who live sordid, debauched lives in post-apocalyptic Britain in the late 20th century.
In Night Train, a young woman has been found dead. And the central character, a female police officer, is put in charge of the investigation. It looks like suicide, but the victim doesn't seem to have had the reason to kill herself.
Martin Amis is probably fiction's angriest writer. His urban satires have provoked extreme reactions in Britain. Martin sees a fouler England than his father, a former angry young man, did. London is a pub, he declares, looking disgustedly out of his study window into the grey street below. We are in a gentle, deep decline, he says quietly. Not as frenzied as America's, but perhaps even more poignant, more tragic.